got another great lineup for you on this episode of Bridge TV. Performances from native KC musicians, video highlights of what's happening in the culture scene, and interviews with traveling national acts. Now, of course, I'm a little biased, but what I look forward to each week is sharing with you the cool in-studios that Chris Aguirian and I get to do on the 8160. Now, if you're not already familiar, the 8160 is a radio show that airs Tuesdays at 6 p.m. on 90.9 FM. But if you miss it, you can always check out the playlist and subscribe to the podcast at bridge909.org. So let's jump right in with KC-based band Myrie Wild.
They're now going to sit down to my seven questions.
Dun, dun, dun.
If you listen to the show on a regular basis, we ask our guests every week, musicians or normal people otherwise, the same seven questions to try and create a bit of an image, a bit of a picture, a bit of an idea, backstory for these people. Seven questions. You guys ready?
Ready.
Number one, for Julia, what's the first album you remember receiving as a child or buying with your own money?
I think in the fourth grade, I got this album for Christmas, and it was Hilary Duff. And I knew every word to every song, and I loved that CD. So.
Okay.
I honestly can't remember, but one my mom played for me a lot and got for me was Ultimate Manilow by Barry Manilow. American Bandstand on repeat.
I was
every
listening
night.
To that on the way here, actually.
This is
oh, okay.
Spectrum,
sweet.
Man, from Hillary Duff to Barry Manilow. That's fantastic.
Question number two. What was the first concert or first local band you remember seeing?
Honestly, the first concerts I remember going to, my older brother has always played in bands throughout high school and stuff like that. So I kind of grew up seeing, just watching his bands, and my whole family is musical, so
what
I kind of.
What bands was your brother in?
Aeromexico was one of them. That was my favorite one. But he's not really in bands anymore, but he still plays music, and he's a really great musician.
Shout out Jesse Hamilton. Mine was probably Reliant K at the Beaumont Club, fifth grade.
Rest in peace,
Beaumont
Club.
Rest in peace.
Number three, what's your favorite film that has anything to do with music?
There's this really great documentary. It's actually on Netflix, but it's called 20 Feet from Stardom. It's about backup singers, and it's amazing.
It's a great movie.
It is.
And it's, well, I don't know about now, but it was on there last week.
Yeah.
So if you have Netflix, you can jump on and watch that.
So good.
And Emily?
Talahina Sky by Kings of Leon documentary.
I didn't know there was a documentary by Kings of Leon.
Check it out.
It's really good.
Yeah.
I'll leave
just,
that there.
Yeah, just stop, Chris.
What?
He's a
hater.
Number four.
Let it go.
If you could hop on a van or tour bus with any current touring band, who would it be?
Probably Brandi Carlile, just because I respect her music so much. I love it. So.
And Emily?
Paramore. Be a blast.
They were here not long ago out at the Independence Event Center.
Mm-hmm.
Was that with Metric?
I didn't go, honestly. I've been to so many shows from them.
Paramore and Metric.
It was
with
Metric. Yeah,
that makes sense.
Oh, Metric.
Yeah.
Number five, what's a KC band or musician that's heavily impacted you?
Lately, Katie Gein and the girls. I just love what they're doing, and I just think they're awesome. They're really sweet, and they're getting a lot of attention.
And Emily?
Easy answer, Author and the Illustrator.
Nice.
Like, from high school on, I mean, Ian's drum sound inspired my drum sound, and Zach Hames, again, just a good friend, so.
That's awesome.
Love their music.
Number six, what song do you wish you would have written?
Hands down, my favorite song, Queen by Janelle Monáe.
Ooh!
My favorite.
Kansas City's own.
Nice.
Yes. White Christmas, best-selling single of all time. So.
See?
Yes!
Bing Crosby.
There's the cash grab.
Yeah.
And then there's the soulful
the passion.
It's still a good song.
Yeah. And some Barry Manilow.
Barry Manilow does White Christmas.
Yep. He probably did.
Last question, number seven. Complete this sentence. Without music, I would be?
Really sad.
Me too.
Probably.
My ADD would probably be way worse than it is now.
Street, and I feel the mountains calling me.
this distance. Meet me where the path does end. Hear a faraway calling. Listen to unknown voices. Look off to the strangest distance. Meet me where the path does end. This world's full of places I'd like to go. These lands are full of life and love I'd like to know. Hands were made to weather, build and climb.
Okay, so I know I'm not alone when I say that KC gives us a lot to be proud of. From a great music scene to some pretty amazing entrepreneurs. In our digital series, Show Me, we introduce you to six stories that are turning us all on to some of the movers and shakers in our city. This week, we give you a look into the life and entrepreneurial spirit of food blogger, Gimme Some Ovens, Allie E. Bright.
My blog has been like exceptionally lucky. We've continued to grow year after year, and I think it's now to the point where we had over 6 million page views this past month, which meant that I think about 4+ million people actually came to my blog last month.
We can build upon the show. We'll follow every song until we go.
Which just blows my mind. It's just, it's crazy. But that's the internet. My name is Allie E. Wright, and I run a recipe blog called Gimme Some Oven, where I create recipes that are quick and easy, usually fresh and delicious, and I share them with the internet. I think that people do think that I cook all day long, and I wish I did. That would be awesome. But there's just, the reality is I'm an entrepreneur and I'm self-employed, and there's a lot to running a business. And so I spend a lot of time actually on the tech side of the business, like running a website. There's a lot to that. Managing the ads that go on behind the scenes, managing all of the programming that goes on with my actual website. I spend a lot of time doing my own marketing for the site, because it's kind of like I could spend all this time creating these amazing recipes, but unless I know how to market them and get them to people, they probably won't see them. So I do spend a lot of time not only actively marketing my stuff, but researching best practices in marketing, especially with social media. I have to spend a lot of time doing things with finances or working on, you know, the not fun stuff like taxes, or, you know, just being able to keep the business going and keep tabs on everything. The blog has reached a point now where and the blogging industry has reached a point where there are actually people who will manage my advertising. And so I have a guy who I've never met who basically handles all of my ads and all of the people who want to run, all of the brands who want to run ads on my site. And so there's a lot of work to keep up the monetization side of blogging, as well as the fun part of it, which is the content creation. I began food blogging just totally as a hobby, probably about 5 years ago. I, at the time, had a bunch of friends who did not cook, And it was always the sort of thing where I'd go to a party and bring an appetizer or something, and everyone would email afterwards and ask for the recipe and ask if I could teach them how to make it. And so when I heard about the idea of a food blog, I thought it was just a brilliant place to organize your recipes and be able to share them with people. I'd say the number one question I get is how, everybody's always afraid to ask, but then they do, how I make money. And that was something that I wondered too with getting into blogging. My first, probably about 2 years with the blog, I actually did not monetize. I didn't really realize it was possible. I was kind of in my own little world with blogging the first few years and just totally did it for fun. But then once I realized that you could monetize, I learned all about the ad industry. And specifically for blogs, that's mostly sidebar ads. Anytime that you see, you know, just a little ad at the top or on the side of a page, usually that means that a blogger is making a fraction of a penny. But once you start to get tens or hundreds of thousands of page views, those fractions of pennies can actually turn into an income that you can live on. Kansas City actually has a thriving blogging community. It's actually kind of one of the little meccas, I would say, in the nation where there are maybe an exceptional number of bloggers and some great bloggers. I feel very proud of the fact that Kansas City is home to such talented and successful and just, I don't know, such a kind group of bloggers. I always get very disappointed when people think that Kansas City is flyover territory. I spend a lot of time now traveling on the coast, and people always seem surprised when I tell them that I'm from Kansas City and that I'm a part of a community that is so artistic and innovative and there's so many entrepreneurs. And I just want to tell them, yes, like the city is alive and it's growing and we have the best people in Kansas City. They are kind, they are smart, they're creative, and I don't know. I just feel like, yeah, the people here are the most important thing in the world to me, and they are the people who make this city.
We are in the Bower, and this is our space. You know, we use a lot of satin. This is a metallic taffeta. You don't think I talk, but when there's a camera on.
Yeah, maybe we should get cameras more often.
I know. We're minimalists. We like it to be clean. The seam is completely enclosed.
I think fashion gives people an outlet to kind of show on the outside who they are on the inside. And for us, architecture is a, you know, it's a name that embodies this sort of modern, minimalist feel. We're trying to build clothing that people can wear and wear in whatever modern context they find themselves in. So,
I mean, ultimately, we're developing a commercially viable wearable art. You know, you hear wearable art and you think kind of some outrageous things, but this would be wearable art that someone would want to wear and be seen in and be recognized for it. And that, you know, is what the architecture part is supposed to be.
How many of those sheer tops?
We've been married almost 17 years, so I think kind of sometimes we can just say a simple idea.
Not even sure. Put anything in it.
And either one of us can just go with that.
We'll just make sure that that's kind of straight like it is now. Yeah.
And probably come up with something similar to the other one's idea too. Since we've been married, most of our jobs have been pretty closely tied to each other. I am a college instructor in fashion, so I teach courses in fashion design and in fashion marketing. I still do things at the school monthly. Okay. I'm just not teaching classes this quarter.
I work for Sporting Kansas City, which is a Major League Soccer team. Primarily, I work on everything that has to do with our merchandise. So work on designing the player uniforms all the way down to the scarves that we sell at a game. We're selling as much as a typical mall store might do in a month. We're doing in 3 hours, so we want to make sure everything is set right. We've got everything as efficient as possible. And so before the game, we're just kind of finalizing all those details.
Rob Heinemann, he's the CEO. He had a description for you. What was that?
Yeah, I mean, it's a funny one. When I met Rob a few years ago, one of the things we talked about was, my role with the team.
It's working good.
Cool.
He'll kid me about it, but he describes me as the vice president of cool. And, I think it's funny, but at the same time, it is something that I take seriously. So from everything that we do.
I'm going to tweet out a photo of this scarf.
I'm there to make sure our brand's cool and our brand's growing.
Your head's growing. I hand draft patterns.
Well, let's say I was going to put a dart in here somewhere.
Which means we have an inspiration we come up with, so, and we kind of look at some styling details, silhouettes we like.
Then here's some other inspiration pictures.
But then I hand draft patterns from scratch or from something, a block or a basic template. And then once we know that the sizing works, I make the patterns. Then I cut it out and sew it in actual fabric. It was fun because it's always fun to gather with a big group of creatives.
It's a big group of people, and I think it's a community of folks who are, looking for a creative outlet, and so it's something that's pretty fun to be a part of.
There were a lot of interesting things going on. It was just a fun night, fun place to be. Last half hour before they go on will be a little bit stressful.
I need that one.
What if by chance one of them lost weight, one of them gained weight? I mean, who knows exactly in a week's time what might happen?
See, I think it might look better with just the top.
Or you thought you made the right size belt and it didn't exactly turn out to be the right size, or something could happen. But we want to look at each one before they go out there and make sure it's exactly what we'd envisioned before she hits the runway and we have it, photographed.
Chapter is putting as much effort into the business as we have into the design.
This band just announced a pretty cool gig with the Avett Brothers happening in KC this summer, but we got to hang out with them in our studios last year. Check out John Hart's 909 session with Old Crow Medicine Show.
There's a lot of energy in the building the last couple of days. A lot of people really excited about Old Crow Medicine Show coming into our studios. And you know, I don't understand how radio works. I don't understand the science of it. I kind of think it's magic. And so I think that it's possible that love can go over the radio airwaves as well as anything else.
Right
so,
on.
I imagine the people are feeling that right now. And so because we have such love, I'm dedicated to making this hopefully the third best radio experience that you've ever had. I say the third best catch because you got your own radio show, and it'd just be arrogant to assume that we could do better than you. And I think maybe the first best has got to be based around September 17th.
You know, September 17th was an exciting day for the Old Crow as we became members of America's most beloved broadcast, the Grand Old Opry, the longest running radio show in American history. And we are the newest members of that esteemed family, and it's all right to applaud that. Yeah! And we're so happy to be in Kansas City today.
You know, I have to ask you, when you were playing a gig in Cleveland and Marty Stewart came on stage, now, did you know what was coming?
We really didn't. Marty's the kind of guy that that shows up places with his mandolin in hand. So we didn't really think that much of it when he walked on the stage in Cleveland. But when they rolled out the microphone that said WSM AM 650 Grand Ole Opry, we got a sneaking suspicion something was awry.
You know, I was watching the video, and I was trying to decide if you guys were surprised, and I thought that you might have been. And the reason why is we got about halfway through it, and Critter took his hat off. Like a sign of respect.
Did I do this number?
Yeah, I think so.
I don't often take my hat off.
Did you know that Critter has got roots here in this part of the country? I used to live in Missouri myself. Critter's got roots over in Kansas, so we feel a little bit of a homecoming every time we get to play here in the middle of the heart of it all.
Now, I'm just sort of pulling this out of the ether, but didn't you have a grade school experience with John Hartford?
Yeah, in over in St. Louis.
Yeah, yeah.
Am I allowed to say that here on this station, St. Louis?
Well, you know, once. You've already said it twice, so you're messing with us now.
I usually say we got robbed in... I'll leave
now,
that part
when
out.
When you're saying you got robbed in, were you talking about an experience in East St. Louis, or were you talking about the 85 World Series?
Well said, Royals fans. And I'll never forget Dan Quisenberry for that.
He was a lovely guy.
Isn't that walking in y'all got Andy Van Slyke?
What now?
Or is that the other way around?
No, he went to the Braves.
Oh, the Pirates.
After the Braves.
Oh, okay. Never mind. Scratch that.
You know, I think that, you know, one of the things that I just want to say up front is that I think that the real story of this band is that you're so tied to tradition that you really kind of started out just doing other people's music. But you guys, and I'm talking multiples here, have turned into great, great songwriters. You know, so much of popular music, you know, and we listen to a lot of it here. It's about the rhythm section. It's about the driving rhythm and the tempo. And we love driving rhythm and tempo, but a lot of times that's the heart of what is there. And with you guys, the heart of it is the song.
Well, we love the poetry and music, and we love the lyricism. And we've been schooled, we've been immersed in the canon of American song. And that's simply, I believe it's where the greatest poetry of the ages in our country comes from. It's these folk songs, this distillation of humanity's struggle to make a living, to bring up their kids right, and to find a little bit of joy in the hardships of living. And there's just so many great songs out there. So we really did begin as a band that was playing music of the 1920s and 30s, delving deep and finding old songs. And that really informed the original material that we write.
Old Crow Medicine Show going to be in concert tonight at the Uptown Theater. Carolina Chocolate drops open. Got a brand new CD, Remedy. And I just, you know, what little I've read about it makes me feel like you found sort of a new comfort in the studio this time around.
Yeah, the studio's been a great place. This studio is a great place. We're really comfortable here right now. It's a nice temperature in here.
Well, we'd love to hear some music.
Yeah, well, let's get, you got your dancing shoes on out there, KC? All right, fire it up.
Old Crow Medicine Show. I think, you know, we have a...
All right.
You know, we have an audience that's been fairly trained to sort of honor the sanctity of the performance, but I think that in the case of Old Crow Medicine Show, the audience is the eighth
There's
member
no
of the band.
There's no honor or sanctity here.
The sanctity is found in the bottom of the mason jar, right?
Yes, that's a good place to find it.
And you hit the bottom on the front porch. So... You know, after, you know, this is such a, you guys have such an interesting story. This is a band that was born of busking.
Do you all know what that is? Busking. It means playing on the street corner for tips. And it's true, that's how we started. And we got quite good at it. We played in most American cities, and we played a lot in Canada. We busked in New York and New Orleans and Seattle and Ottawa and Vancouver. And it was a great way to hone some of the skills that we're still using today. I mean, this is essentially a curb we're on right now, and y'all are just walking by, sorta.
So when you asked the audience if they knew what busking was and you went straight to the change, was that sort of like an invitation? Because I imagine that these people are, some of them are probably pretty well healed.
We take check cards now. We have a cube, you just swipe it.
Little card reader, yeah. You know, so you're massively hungover one morning in North Carolina. Did you pick the front of that pharmacy for a particular reason?
That was a spot that we used to hit. You know, we'd play there on the weekends. This is called Boone Drug, a pharmacy in Boone, North Carolina.
Yeah.
Well, we were playing out in front of it, you know, on the 5th of July, as you say, a little bit weary. Because the 4th of July was when we ran all that liquor. You know, we had learned how to make it on the stovetop, but then this was our chance to really make it out in the yard. There's a big difference between making whiskey in your house and in your yard.
So
some of your viewers down in the southwestern corner of the state might know what I'm talking about. Anyhow, up walks a woman who liked what she was hearing, and she said, "Y'all gonna be here for a while? I'm gonna go get my daddy. He loves this kind of music." And she came back about 40 minutes later and walked her father, Doc Watson, across the street, who took a long listen, just sort of drank us in with his great big ear, and said, right on the spot, "That's some of the most authentic old-time music I heard in a long time. I'd like you boys to play the festival I have for my boy, the Merle Watson Festival."
And from there, you got, it's a series of, it's funny when you start to have success, everybody discovers you, right? I mean, how many people discovered your band? You ended up with a contract with a record label, agent, the whole nine yards. It just snowballed from there.
Yeah, but it was a real slow rolling, you know, like an uphill snowball, man.
Kind of one you put in your freezer over the summer and then get out and it's real hard and you gotta like put it outside again to roll it, you know?
Well, you know, we're glad that journey led you here, and we'd love to hear another song.
Yeah, we'd love to do one. This is a song off of our new album, Remedy. It came out last week. We're happy to be here in Kansas City tonight promoting it. And this is a song that, over the past couple of years, we've been getting a lot of letters that come from APO addresses. You know, for the longest time, they all came from Iraq, from Basra and Mosul. And Air Force bases around there in Saudi Arabia. Nowadays, all the letters come from Kandahar and Jalalabad City and places in Afghanistan. Anyhow, when you get letters like that, it gives you a perspective that not everybody has. We had some fans that came out to see us on the release of our album night in Nashville who were based down here at Fort Riley over in Kansas. And anyhow, we sing this song with all of those men and women in mind who... And we hope they come home soon. This one's called Dearly Departed Friend. Service went the way it should have gone. No one talked too loud or cried too long. Except your mama's new boyfriend. He went on and on while they laid you in the ground. Right about then, a truck backfired and all the boys, they flinched their heads. Yeah, that shook me up, I guess. I've been home a month now and I still can't get no rest. I'm standing by the grave of a dearly departed friend. Nothing much to say except sorry it turned out like it did. 21 guns for 21 years and American flags in the wind. Standing by the grave of a dearly departed friend. Barbecue grills and lawnmowers. Kids on four-wheelers and ice cream trucks. Yeah, they buried you on a Saturday. St. Louis lost to Kansas City. You would've liked that, I know. Afterwards, we went to Old Charlie's. Your mama's boyfriend got drunk, saying it should've been me. And I wish it was him, I mean. So I went home, got drunk, and watched the TV. I'm standing by the grave of a dearly departed friend. With nothing much to say except sorry it turned out like it did. 21 guns for 21 years and American flags in the wind. Standing by the grave of a dearly departed friend. Hey, there's only one road leads out of this town and it comes right back. So I just drive in circles, circles, and I try not to blow my stack. And at the mall and the motor mile, it's just as lonesome as
yellow ribbon round the old hackberry tree and tamp the dirt down. Y'all going home now. There ain't nothing here to see. I'm standing by the grave of a dearly departed friend, with nothing much to say except sorry it turned out like it did. 21 guns for 21 years and American flags in the wind. Standing by the grave of a dearly departed friend. Buddy, I'm just standing by the grave of a dearly departed friend.
Dearly Departed Friend, one of the brand new tracks from Remedy done live here in the Bridge Studios. Old Crow Medicine Show going to be appearing live tonight at the Uptown Theater with the Carolina Chocolate Drops, and I'm sure that you'll have copies of Remedy at the merch table tonight. It's going to be a good, good, good night in Kansas City. You guys play Lawrence a lot. You don't get around to Kansas City as much.
Well, we started playing outdoors just south of town in that open-air venue they've got. I can't remember the name of it. Maybe it's called like Midtown Mix or something. Anyhow, it looks like a junkyard.
Yeah, Crossroads.
The Crossroads. Yeah, yeah. It doesn't look like a junkyard at all. It's a fine establishment. Yeah. But we've moved up now. There's a turret in the place we're playing tonight.
So, Ketch, you and Critter go all the way back to seventh grade, and you bonded over the Red Badge of Courage. You did a skit. Do you remember any of that skit?
Where'd you get that? Wikipedia?
I don't know. I started out with about 79 pages of notes and whittled it down. Wow. So
yeah, it was Red Badge of Courage. We had a Mr. Hahn's history class. We had a skit that we worked out, and I got shot in the gut, and Ketch gave me water, and we were in seventh grade, so we tried to make it as brutal as possible for the class.
It was kind of almost like a theatrical murder ballad.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've been hanging out together for like 23 years now.
Yeah. Quick, everybody, do the math. So had you just like gotten into Bob Dylan by that point?
Yeah, Critter and I really kind of got into Bob together, you know, and it was Critter, in fact, who brought me minute and a half outtake recording of Bob Dylan singing a song called Rock Me Mama, which was recorded in 1972. And that's the song that after he shared it with me, I heard it and I knew it was a fine song, but it was unfinished, so I finished it. And that's become our most popular song. It's called Wagon Wheel.
So so you started playing this song when you were 17, and then like years went by, Wagon Wheel became a big hit in like 2004. So I was curious, did you have it written as Wagon Wheel back when you were 17, or did it evolve?
I called it Rock Me Mama for almost 10 years. You know, I wrote it in 95, and Bob Dylan wrote it in 73, and Bob Dylan claimed that it came from Arthur Crudup, who was from Memphis. They called him Big Boy. Now, and so that's in Memphis in the 50s. Now, Big Boy said that he learned it from Big Bill Brunzi, so that takes us to Chicago in the 20s. So by the time it got to me, it was a well-worn song.
So parts of this song are about 95 years old now.
Yeah, it's a real folk song.
Yeah, so you write this song, and you're performing it, and then it comes time to put it on the record, and it's sort of like, well, songwriting credits. How do I handle that?
Yeah, it gets a little complicated there because, you know, you got to get Bob's approval.
Yeah.
So we you know, tried to find the right channels to get a hold of Mr. Dylan, and eventually through his manager, Jeff Rosen, were able to do that, and Bob signed off on it, and it became a co-write with the master.
Yeah, which is, you know, I mean, just looking at that, you know, like your name and Bob Dylan's name, a little slash in between them, I mean, that has to feel pretty amazing, but...
Giddy with delight.
Yeah. Yeah, now, I know that, you know, my word doesn't stand for much, but That's a song that's been much covered, and your version is my favorite version. But Darius Rucker just had a lot of success with that. Took it to number one on the commercial country side, and that prompted Bob Dylan to kind of get in touch.
Yeah, you know, of all the people that were listening, and millions were, our mothers and all of y'all and people around the country and around the world heard Darius Rucker singing our song, and there was one set of ears that mattered most, and they were Bob Dylan's. He was listening too. And he was tickled that he had a number one record. That's not something that happens a lot in their world. You know, it's, to me, all of his songs are number one songs, but they actually, you know, they didn't sell all like Hootie's yeah. did. Anyhow, he was listening, and again, through his manager, Jeff Rosen, it's important to mention, we've never met Bob Dylan, but through his manager, he reached out to us to congratulate us on the song going number one, and then shortly thereafter, sent us another song from the same batch.
Now, the first song, you had a minute and a half to work with. This time around, 26 seconds.
Yeah, this was a real shorty.
Now, could you understand all the words?
Yeah, with Rock Me Mama, there's a lot of mumbling, so that one was really hard to figure out. The problem with this one was that there's a lot of giggling. He had a lot of gals there in the studio with him, and they're just sort of chatting back and forth during the take. And all you can really make out is Sweet Amarillo and pillow a lot of times. I mean, he must have put the word pillow next to Amarillo three times in the chorus.
Well, at least we know what Bob was thinking about. So when you got that music, what was your initial reaction? Did you run around and tell everybody?
No, I kept it to myself like a big slice of cake you might hoard on the bus and not put in the refrigerator so everyone else can eat it. So I held on to it for a few days before I let the cat out of the bag that this total dream come true, you know, surreal stuff that dreams are made of thing was happening.
So when you wrote Wagon Wheel, it was, you were 17 and you weren't thinking about Bob Dylan eventually hearing what you were going to do. You just did it, and then it kind of evolved and it turned into what it turned into. But this time around, Bob Dylan has sent you this and you know that he's going to be checking out what you're doing. And I'm assuming that it was a different experience.
Yeah, it was different this go around. We worked up the song and we made a work tape of it, and you could just tell everybody was a little stiff in their playing because they knew, well, Bob Dylan's gonna hear this. Really, he's yeah. gonna listen to this and tell us what he thinks. So, but we started to loosen up a little bit, and we recorded it up in Montreal during a sound check, and sent it off to Bob. And a few weeks before we went into the studio to cut Remedy, Bob got back to us and he said, you know, it sounds great. I love it. And Ketch should play the fiddle, not the harmonica, and the chorus needs to come at the 16th bar, not the 32nd. And so that's how it came to be. Bob kind of had a little production role in it, and we did it exactly like he said to do it, and it's like the song just opened up when we did what he prescribed.
So when you went to finish Bob Dylan's lyrics, which is sort of like, I mean, a daunting task. What was the mental approach that you took? What was the storyline that you developed?
Well, I was in Chattanooga. See, I got to do all this stuff on the road in a parking lot, you know, because we're an itinerant group. So I sat down with Critter, you know, and we talked about, well, what is it? What is the crossroads of Amarillo, Texas, and Bob Dylan? Or maybe it's not even Amarillo. Maybe it's just a girl named Amarillo or some concept. But anyhow, we're pretty narrative thinking guys. Remember Red Badge of Courage, you know? We like a storyline. And so we set a young Bob Dylan on a course that journeyed through the heartland. And
Topeka.
And, yeah, he stops in Topeka, he crosses the Missouri River. We were playing in Oklahoma last week, and unfortunately Bob cut all of the verse about Oklahoma. Such a bummer, especially if you're from Ponca City.
Well, if you want to, you can put that back in here, you know. But we'd love to hear that.
We're going to play it for you now. This one's called Sweet Amarillo.
Sweet Amarillo.
across the wide Missouri, where the cool waters flow. When I got to Topeka, I looked up your name, but they said you rode off with the last rodeo. Drifts into the arms of a long distance lover. Then they turn like a cover and dance the red over till the light of the dawn.
That's the latest Old Crow Bob Dylan co-write with about 40 years between the pen strokes.
You think there's going to be more?
Oh, I mean, does lightning strike twice, thrice now? How could you ask for more?
You know, I'm going to go back to the way I started this by complimenting you guys seriously enough that you all get embarrassed and have to look at your feet and do the aw shucks thing. The thing that I really don't like about the Bob Dylan story is, you know, you guys are traditionalists, and you take great pride in the endorsements and the helping hands that you've gotten from people that believed in you, people like Marty Stewart and Doc Watson and Merle Haggard, and now, of course, Bob Dylan. But the thing that really blesses you and the thing that really anoints you is your own body of work. And you guys have been writing things that are going to be standards. And I don't know if you guys have really taken that into your own hearts yet, whether you really own it or not. But there are some great songs coming out of Old Crow Medicine Show. And we really appreciate you sharing them with us today.
Thank you.
Old Crow Medicine Show, tonight, Uptown Theater, Carolina Chocolate Drops open. They are great, too. That's going to be a rollicking, fun night. And the new CD is called Remedy, Old Crow Medicine Show, live here on the bridge. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you. Thanks for having us. Thanks so much.
Those guys are so much fun, man. I think that'd be a really cool tour bus to be on, and they absolutely bring it on stage. That'll wrap up another hour of Bridge TV. I'm Sarah Bradshaw. Thanks for turning on, tuning in, and listening local.